Okay, thank you. On the 18th of February 1943, Hans and Sophie Scholl, a brother and sister, both students at the University of Munich, deposited piles of pamphlets around the atrium at the entrance to the main university building. As they were leaving, Sophie pushed a pile of these pamphlets off the edge of the balustrade so that they cascaded down into the empty hall below. A university caretaker spotted them, the Gestapo were called, and they were arrested. 4 days later, on the 22nd of February, they were put on trial along with another student, Christoph Probst, and by 5 o'clock the same evening, they had been executed by guillotine. The students had been part of a clandestine group, a resistance group called Die Weiße Rose, the White Rose, which in the early 1940s wrote, printed, and distributed 6 pamphlets calling for resistance to Nazism and an end to the Second World War. There were 6 principal members of the Munich-based group. Students, Hans Scholl and Sophie Scholl, Christoph Probst, Alexander Schmorell, Willy Graf, and a professor, Kurt Huber, who taught philosophy and musicology. Schmorell, Graf and Huber were also arrested, tried and executed. Further trials and punishments followed as other members of the group beyond Munich were rounded up. In this brief talk, I want to show you something of the pamphlets that the White Rose wrote, copied and distributed. These are fascinating texts, and they speak to the power of the written word and how culture can inform political action. The White Rose Project, which I run here in Oxford, is working to raise awareness in the UK of this aspect of modern German history. And this year, 15 undergraduate students from 10 colleges have worked on a new collaborative translation of the pamphlets, and it's their translations which I'll quote from in this talk. They're also going to be published next month. They'll be available in print and online. And I'm very pleased that one of the student translators is here today. There'll also be an exhibition in the Bodleian. This opens on the 18th of May, for which the students have also been printing posters drawn of slogans drawn from and inspired by the White Rose pamphlets. To the pamphlets then. The Flugblatt, or pamphlet, was the first medium of mass communication, and in the history of the German-speaking lands, we find pamphlets and flyers used to disseminate ideas and information for the purposes of propaganda and control, as well as provocation and resistance. Initially, such flyers were sold rather than distributed free of charge. It's estimated that in the 1520s, for example, a 4-page flyer would have cost a Pfennig, which is basically the equivalent of a mug of beer. 5 of the 6 White Rose pamphlets covered 2 sides of roughly A4 paper. The 6th took up only 1 side. The pamphlets were typed and copied using a second-hand duplicating machine. The group obtained paper, envelopes, stencils and stamps, which was no easy feat during wartime, and they distributed the pamphlets by leaving them in telephone boxes, they posted them to individuals, and they left them around the university. At great risk, they took pamphlets to other cities, where, amongst their wider circle of friends, they found those who would further copy and distribute the material. Copies appeared in Stuttgart, Cologne, Vienna, Freiburg, Chemnitz, Hamburg, Innsbruck, and Berlin. The White Rose pamphlets reflect the development of the group's approach and the changing situation as the war progressed. They draw on a range of philosophical ideas and influences and include quotations from German writers such as Goethe, Schiller, and Novalis, as well as Aristotle, the Old Testament, and the ancient Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu. The first 4 pamphlets were written by Hans Scholl and Alex Schmorell between June and July 1942. Each begins with the heading Pamphlets of the White Rose and a corresponding number, suggesting that from the very beginning they had intended to produce a series of pamphlets. Indeed, in the 3rd pamphlet, they indicate that a certain theme will be picked up again in a future text. All but the final pamphlet end with instructions to the reader to make and distribute further copies of it, from "we urge you to transcribe this pamphlet, make as many copies as you can and distribute them," to "support the resistance movement, distribute the pamphlets." The pamphlets were designed to stir up the people, to confront them with truths which the group believed they were deliberately ignoring, either through fear or obstinacy. From the very beginning, their language is forceful, even shocking. "If every one of us waits for someone else to start, then the herald of avenging nemesis will draw ever closer until the last sacrificial victim is vainly thrown into the jaws of a demon that will never be sated. In the second pamphlet, they explicitly denounce the persecution of European Jews, writing, "Since the conquest of Poland, 300,000 Jews have been murdered in that country in the most bestial manner. Here we see the most horrific crime against human dignity, a crime unparalleled in all of human history." They attempt to show how their fellow Germans have been taken in by Nazism and urge readers to open their eyes to the atrocities being committed in the name of the regime. Until the outbreak of war, the vast majority of the German people were blinded. The National Socialists did not show their true face. But now, since they have been seen for what they are, the highest and only duty, the most sacred duty even, of every German must be to destroy these beasts. Elsewhere, they mock the Nazis. For example, poking fun at Adolf Hitler's Mein Kampf, My Struggle, calling it a book which, despite having been written in the most appalling German I've ever read, has been elevated to biblical status by this nation of poets and philosophers. They call on readers to engage in passive resistance, to bring down National Socialism, and to bring an end to the war. They advocate sabotage of factories, Nazi events, universities, cultural events, the arts, and the media. They even warn against giving to charity street collections, because this will only continue to benefit and support the state. Several individuals influenced the group, among them Theodor Hecker, an authority on Kierkegaard and translator of John Henry Cardinal Newman. Under the Nazis, Hecker was banned from speaking publicly or publishing. He kept a secret journal documenting his internal resistance to the regime, which his teenage daughter smuggled out of his flat when it was searched by the Gestapo. Hecker's influence is discernible in the fourth pamphlet, which draws on theology and metaphysics, presenting Hitler as the Antichrist. Every word that comes out of Hitler's mouth is a lie. When he says peace, he means war. And when he blasphemously invokes the name of the Almighty, he means the power of the evil one, of the fallen angel, of Satan. His mouth is the stinking maw of hell, and his power is, in its very essence, corrupt. The fourth pamphlet ends with an assurance that the White Rose is not in the pay of a foreign power, before boldly declaring, "We will never be silent. We are your bad conscience. The White Rose will never leave you in peace." Hans and Alex wrote the fourth pamphlet in July 1942. Later that month, they and Willy Graf, all medical students conscripted into military service, left Munich for a three-month tour of duty at the Russian front. When they returned, they resumed the pamphlet campaign. And over the course of two nights in February 1943, Hans, Alex and Willy graffitied the walls of several Munich buildings. Their slogans included "Down with Hitler," "Hitler mass murderer," and simply "Freedom." Kurt Huber, the professor, edited the fifth leaflet in January 43 based on a draft by Hans. Here, there is an even greater sense of urgency. Hitler cannot win the war. He can only prolong it. His guilt and the guilt of his followers continually exceeds all boundaries. Just punishment is nigh. Also striking here is the focus on what will happen after the war, how Germany will be seen by the rest of the world in the years to come. Germans, shall we be forever hated and shunned by the whole world? No. So separate yourselves from the subhuman nature of National Socialism. Act. Prove that you think differently. A new fight for liberation is at hand. Here they take the pejorative word the Nazis used to refer to Jews and other persecuted groups, Untermenschen, subhumans, and turn it right back round to the Nazis themselves. The sixth pamphlet was written by Kurt Huber in February 1943, following the German army's terrible defeat at Stalingrad. Huber lays the blame for this squarely at Hitler's door. Unlike the others, this pamphlet is addressed directly to fellow students and dispenses with the closing plea to make and distribute further copies. It calls on the students to rise up and take control of Germany's future. For us, there is only one slogan: fight against the party. Get out of the lecture halls of the SS and senior leaders and party sycophants. There is no threat that can deter us, not even the closure of our universities. It is the duty of each and every one of us to fight for our future, our freedom and honour in a political system conscious of its own moral responsibility. When Hans and Sophie were arrested in February 1943, Hans had the rough version of a seventh leaflet drafted by Christoph Probst in his pocket. Hans tried to swallow the incriminating paper, but was unable to do so, and it was discovered. The sixth pamphlet, however, was smuggled out of the country, and in the summer of 1943, millions of copies were dropped by the RAF over Germany. The text bore a new title, Manifesto of the Munich Students. The same year, the exiled German novelist Thomas Mann dedicated one of his regular BBC broadcasts to the White Rose, declaring, "Good, splendid young people, you shall not have died in vain, you shall not be forgotten. A new faith in freedom and honour is dawning." The war would roll on for a further 2 years, but the White Rose would indeed not be forgotten. The story of the White Rose is best told when the group members speak for themselves, in their private writings and in the pamphlets, and not when they are idealised or mythologised. They were extraordinary in what they did, and reading their letters and diaries, were confronted with deeply thoughtful and serious young people, extremely well read in literature and philosophy, and that much is clear, I think, from the pamphlets. But they were also quite ordinary students. They lived, loved, complained, went to lectures, went to parties, and so on. They were also not without a sense of humour. For example, Hans, in a letter to his parents and sister in March 1942, commented that he wasn't sure if they'd received his last letter and that the post was very irregular. He adds, with more than a hint of mischief, "I really sympathise with the Gestapo, having to decipher all those different handwritings, some of which are highly illegible. But that's what they're paid to do, and after all, duty is duty, gentlemen, isn't it?" There's been criticism of the group's youthful impetuosity. Some have questioned how much concrete change they really achieved at the time. Nevertheless, especially for those of us who work day in, day out with young people, this history provides a moving and inspiring example of how conscience and moral courage can challenge injustice through the power of writing. I'd like to give the final word to one of the students who worked on the translation project. She writes, "These were individuals who wanted more than anything to provoke action, to awaken their fellow Germans and inspire their resistance to the regime. In an age in which young people are constantly being accused of apolitical cynicism, I hope our translation of these pamphlets can provide an example of the political action our generation can achieve and of the true potential we have to make change in the world." Thank you.